Hello everyone and welcome back to my channel. I'd appreciate it if you hit the like button, subscribe if you'd like. If you're interested in character analyses or analyses videos in general about some of your favorite anime, then this is the channel for you. And if you hit the subscribe button, I promise you won't regret it. Anyway, getting back into the topic, as you can tell by the title of the video, I will be discussing a character that I find to be incredibly fascinating, that being Erwin Smith from Attack on Titan. Now, Erwin Smith has always been an interesting character to me because besides Annie and Reiner, I always question whose side he was really on. I question this not because he'd done anything evil per se, but because he'd always given me the impression that he prioritized his own self-interest over the survival of humanity at large, at times. He even admitted as much when he spoke to Levi before his death. While putting yourself first and being selfish is not always a bad quality, I did find it much harder to grapple with when it came to Erwin. Before this show, I'd always envisioned that a good commander was someone who sought out the path to victory with the least casualties possible, and Erwin seemed to be the exact opposite of that. Instead, he really embodied the idea that there's never a sacrifice too great, besides Eren, of course, and that made me feel like he didn't place enough value on the lives of his fellow countrymen. This caused not only me as a viewer to question him, but many of his own peers within the show to question him and his decisions too. And rightfully so. We saw this occur in season 1, during the Annie ambush within the walls and in the forest. Within the walls, Erwin did not really care how many people would get hurt, lose their homes, or even die in his pursuit of Annie, the female Titan. And when confronted by Niall, the commander of the MP, on whether or not all of the destruction Eren and Annie's fight brought to the city was worth it, Erwin responds that he has faith that it was a step in the right direction. Moving on to season 2, when Erwin lures the abnormal Titans towards Reiner and Bertolt in attempts to recover Eren, we see that his men call him crazy and question his intentions. This action may have led to Eren's retrieval, a successful, retrieval of Eren, but it also led to many of his men losing their lives and him returning with only a fraction of the original group of soldiers he went out with. Moving on to season 3, when he leads his soldiers to their death. Now, let's be clear. By season 3, I began to understand Erwin a lot better and I don't actually hold this against him. Mostly because this was a moment he shared with his men. He went out into the field and died with them. In previous examples, I felt like he used the death of his comrades to get closer to his own aspirations. And while it yields results, it does not make the ride home any less painful for his soldiers. This can also explain why Flock described him as a necessary devil that Paradise needed. I imagine that a lot of the men mirrored the same sentiments but weren't brave enough to voice it. While Erwin did make a lot of questionable choices, the more I got to watch his backstory, the more I began to understand him. While Erwin's dad was taken out by the government for having the audacity to challenge the validity of the history books, Erwin's life mission became the vindication of his father's legacy. And the only way to do that was through the pursuit of the non-negotiable truth. The way in which Erwin sought to arrive at the truth is what Rene Descartes called the Cartesian skepticism. After doing some research, I found an official definition of Cartesian skepticism stating that it is any of a class of skeptical views against empirical knowledge based on the claim that claims to empirical knowledge are defeated by the possibility that we might be deceived insofar as we might be, for example, dreaming, hallucinating, deceived by demons or brains in vats. In other words, it is the idea that in order to get to the center of the truth, you must presume that everything you've been taught from a young age is false, with the exception of things and ideas that can be proven otherwise. An analogy that Descartes used was to imagine you have a basket of apples and you're concerned that some of the apples might be rotten. Since the rot could spread and ruin the apples, the only way to make sure that there is no rot in the basket is to dump out all of the fruit, inspect each apple in turn, and return only the fresh apples to the basket. Now imagine the rotten apple is a lie you've been told. A lie so big, that it has affected how you look at everything else. Now imagine, in order to get to the truth, you have to presume that everything you've been told from a small age is false until proven otherwise. Not only do we see Irwin illustrate this when he challenged Aaron to reconsider who the real enemy was, but we see this play out in his military strategy. During the first attempt to corner the female Titan, Irwin throws his bait by feeding all of the potential recruits information about how Aaron's home in Shiganshina holds a vital secret about the Titans, and how there will be an expedition to Shiganshina to retrieve it. Before the expedition starts, however, he feeds all of his soldiers false information on where Aaron is located and leaves all but a few people in the dark completely on what his plans are. This is a physical representation of Cartesian doubt, otherwise known as Cartesian skepticism. In order to get to the truth about who the traitor in their midst was, he operates under the assumption that anyone can be the traitor, even those closest to him, until proven otherwise. Although there are various scenes in Attack on Titan that made me question Irwin's decisions, by the time season 3 came around, I came to the realization that all of this did not make him a bad commander. Commanders make incredibly hard decisions, and the stakes are high all the time. A great commander cannot allow themselves to regret their decisions. As Irwin states, if you begin to regret, you'll dull your future decisions and let others make your decisions for you. What makes Irwin a great commander was his ability to make a decision and stick to it regardless of the consequences, his ability to instill courage within his soldiers, even in the face of death, his perseverance in situations that would cause most to fold, his pursuit of the truth not only for the sake of vindicating his father, but for the sake of humanity at large, and lastly, his acceptance of the fact that even he must make the ultimate sacrifice of his dreams for the survival of humanity and for the sake of making the sacrifices of those who came before him worth something. Those are my thoughts on Irwin. I think he's a really complicated character. And, you know, as I said in my video about how Aaron acquired true freedom, I mentioned that most, if not all, Attack on Titan characters, they operate in the gray. There's nobody who is absolutely right, and there's really nobody who's absolutely wrong, even some of the characters we really dislike. Anyway, let me know what your thoughts are about this video. Let me know what your thoughts are about Irwin. Do you think that he was a good commander? Anyway, thank you so much for clicking on this video. Please subscribe, like, share if you'd like, and, you know, stay tuned for future videos.